So what I'm going to talk about today is this idea of memory as different material as repetition. And what you see here is a sketch of a compositional sketch, which I'm going to explain in a moment, this way of working. These are the samples that I was just playing for you in an hour. The way that I want to talk about this is not only the pre-compositional material, but in terms of bringing this compositional process into the performance process. So to explain the way that I've been composing now for most of my pieces use this kind of a process. What I do for every piece is I consider it to be an interpretation of an existing piece. In a sense, I do this because what I'm interested in is, I mean, a lot of composers are talking about this, like a composer like Ferneyhough will say the same thing. I'm not so much interested in the material itself. I feel that material can be a marker for style. So I'm not so interested in generating material. What I'm interested in is finding material and then interpreting that material. I also feel that all material that we're using compositionally is, in a sense, coming from the past anyway. So what I do is I consciously make this relationship with the past by using works from the past and by, in a sense, because also as a performer before I was a composer, thinking of myself as a performer, as performing the work as a composer. So what you see here in this diagram, on the left there's a score. Most of the pieces that I use as original material are scored, although I have done one piece that was after traditional music, which of course could be scored after the fact, but it comes from the oral tradition. So then, starting from the score, then I take several different performances of this and combine these recordings into what I call a single maquette. Sometimes what I'm doing, I do this in different ways, sometimes what I'm doing is taking each articulated unit of the different recordings, using an algorithmic method that then measures those articulated units and then time stretches between those, let's say, each of those articulated units according to one, let's say, master version. So let's say in the first version, the first note is 1 second, and in the second version it was 0.5 seconds, so then it's going to be stretched by 2, just that portion, in order to fit on exactly to that other version. So I'm then combining these, and the idea is that, and this is where I'm relating to différence et répétition, in the sense that that by combining different versions, sometimes I'm using, for instance, Renaissance music, in which the tuning is slightly different. So hearing these different recordings at the same time obviously accentuates those differences. So then I assemble the maquette, and then what happens with this maquette is that I do an analysis of this, and sometimes I do some kind of filtering in that analysis. I don't necessarily take everything, and you know, it's very important to say that this is my compositional process, so it's not an objective process. It's not an idea of most objectively and accurately reproducing that. And then from that comes the new composition. And sometimes, and I'll talk about this in a moment, sometimes I integrate elements from the maquette itself into the electronics so that you're actually hearing the maquette in some way through the performance. So obviously then the compositional process also comes about, why am I choosing certain works, what is the aesthetic project of choosing a certain work, what is my relationship to that work. And in a sense, what I'm doing is I'm also through that compositional process investigating my relationship to the past, my relationship to certain musical materials. So I'm going to take an example of that. First of all, before I look at my current practice with this was a piece for clarinet. Actually, this was the first piece which I had written without electronics, in quite a long time. So in a way that was challenging for me. This was written for the Arditi Quartet. And what I did in this piece, I don't know if you recognize when you hear Folklarnacht, it probably reminds you of something. It's Folklarnacht. What I did was I did a homophonic translation of the title. So homophonic translation is when you take the sound, rather than looking for the meaning of a word, you take the sound. And in a sense, this is also representative of this compositional process that I'm using. That I'm not looking for to most accurately represent those materials from the maquette, but I'm looking to somehow find metaphorical relationships between the original material and my new composition. So Folklarnacht is Danish. I have been doing a couple of projects with the Danish language, so I'm interested in doing this. And what it means is night explained. So I was also interested in the kind of new meanings that took on from the homophonic translation. Because for me, Verklatenach is this very typical example of this transition from, you know, say, high romanticism. And it has somewhat expressionistic language. And we associate this expressionistic language with certain of these sort of dark, foreboding qualities. So the idea would be to, through a composition, to sort of explain those properties. So what I decided to do in this, I mean, as I've been using this process that you just saw before of the making of the maquette several times, I decided in this composition to change things a little bit. And what I did was to take the whole second half of the piece. If you know the piece, you know that there's a change to D major in the middle of the piece, and this is according to the this is because of the poetic properties of the poem on which it's based. Because that's a point when there's a turnaround. It's basically this moment of acceptance of the infidelity or past sexual history, actually, of this woman in the poem by her lover. So usually this is this first half, which is in D minor, and the second half goes into this D major. And what I did was I flipped the second half with many, many different recordings. So it's already a bit of a dense version of that, and a bit blurred by those different versions. And I reversed it and flipped it onto the first half, so that these materials are forced to confront one another. So what you see here is, what I'm trying to do here is read the score backwards, which if you've ever tried to read a score backwards, it's really very difficult. It's horrible. Because the rhythms, of course, have their values, right? They have the value of what comes afterwards. Also, it's very strange to hear these melodies backwards a lot. So in any case, this is my trying to figure out. Usually, I try to work just from the recordings because I'm interested in... I'm not interested in a single version of the piece. And that's actually... I don't want to go into too much, but maybe in the discussion we can talk about this. I had been thinking of the term monad for what the piece is. Because it is these multiplicities, I don't think of a piece of music as its score, as it was written by the composer. Obviously, we hear a piece by Beethoven. There's a performance practice that goes with it, the dynamics, everything that we're hearing, even in the later editions, which are written in the score, they were not in that original score. So how does the piece, what is the identity of the piece, where is it situated? It's always situated in the practice, in these multiplicities. So that's partly what I'm interested in this in my own process. But in this case, I did go back to the score because it was so difficult to listen to this backwards. And then this is the score that comes out of it. Oh, I'm sorry, if you didn't see both at the same time, then you don't realize. But for instance, what you see here highlighted in yellow, these parts are going here backwards. And what I do, since it's backwards, I have the performer playing behind the left hand. So I'm going to play a little bit of that now. I'm just going to play the ending. If you listen to the ending of the maquette, this is where you're going to hear these major and minor materials kind of rub up against each other. Find it a little bit humorous when listening to it because this mixture of major and minor. I have to admit, actually, I also had a little bit of idea because this piece was written for Darmstadt, and I had a little bit of an idea of, as soon as I had this idea, I thought, oh, I'm going to make a scandal at Darmstadt and I'm going to have a piece that ends in D major. And no scandal whatsoever, actually, the piece was really appreciated, so I failed in that sense. So this is a corresponding area of the piece. I should remember it. So this is corresponding part of the piece by the as performed by the Eduque Quartet. Even though I showed you these score excerpts before, and even though I was referring to that, it's really the spectral content of the combinations of these recordings that I'm interested in. So therefore what you're hearing is not a playing of the notes of the original score, it's actually an interpretation of recordings, you know, those early performances, other performances, which I then analyze and then make a score from. So what happened, I'll play another little excerpt just in here. What happened in the process with the Arditi Quartet, one of the reasons I also wanted to choose this piece for the Arditi Quartet is that they play sometimes this repertoire, second Viennese school repertoire, and I know they have a very close relationship with that. And I was hoping they would kind of build a relationship with that piece while they were working. And this is for me where the Bergsonisme comes in, that we have this moment when we're experiencing the piece that has a kind of a density of reference, a density of calling into that moment previous experience. Now for someone, it might be you hear that and it could be, if you remember Bergsonisme when he talks about, you could have different pathways of going into that virtual space, of going into a memory space. So it could be, for instance, first of all, you're recognizing a language if someone is speaking that language. What language is that? Then you might be thinking about what is the actual word, what is the meaning of that word, and then further associations with that. So first of all, one might say, oh, this is an expressionistic style, but it's referencing that style, and I feel that there's a certain distance from that style at the same time. And then you might actually recognize Schoenberg, and then you might actually recognize certain phrases. It's important to say this is not the success of the work is reliant upon this. This is not at all this idea. It's not at all a game in which you're trying to find out what it is. But it's a certain, as I say, a densification of the experience by this relationship. I'm going to just play a little another little excerpt, just so you can hear some of the That was a little excerpt I had showed you before, that backwards melody. And so what was happening is, for instance, Ashok, the second violinist of the Arditi Quartet, would somehow be playing in rehearsal and then all of a sudden would stop and say, "Oh, I just recognize something backwards." Because hearing something backwards is a very strange way of remembering it, right? And I was kind of fascinated by this process. And again, this is not a game in which you're trying to recognize things, but I thought, well, this relationship of the performer to the material could be something to explore. Also, there's always a question with the maquette. As I said before, I'll show you. Let me just say this before I say it. I mean, the material is quite obvious. The material is coming from difference. But on all the different levels, the difference of my representation, the difference between the different interpretations of the same piece, which again I feel is part of the identity of the piece. And if I use the word monad for what this identity is for me, maybe objective is a bit of what my own realization is, this kind of dynamic object. So sometimes what I do is I integrate the maquette into the electronics, but I have it played in a sense through the instrument, because I have resonant filters which are created by the playing of the instrument and then play that maquette through. So that's one way in which I integrate it into the actual performance. But I was interested in a further relationship. How could the performer relate to the maquette? Because when you hear it this way together, obviously the instrumental parts are coming from the maquette, the maquette is coming through it, it's very much blended, and it's more of a reinforcement of the difference between the different recordings, if that makes sense, that there's already that vibration in this material that's brought out by bringing into the maquette. So what we're going to do now is show you a demonstration of just what I've been trying in terms of relating to the demo, if you want to come up, Richard, and we'll, okay. and I'll leave this one, this is just about the simultaneity. This is from a repetition, difference of repetition. So, what I decided to do was have the, thank you to Richard Craig for experimenting with this. This is very new. I'm writing a solo piece for Richard, and we've been talking about different ways of using the electronics. And so what's going to happen here is I'm going to give him headphones which actually play a section of the maquette, but when I say a section, it's a sort of spectral band of a maquette, which he then has instructions of the techniques, more or less. Talking about this, still developing of the techniques to use. Now, this would be a bit more strictly scored, but this is just an experiment that we're doing right now. And he's going to be playing after this. Now, you notice these are the first problem I had, obviously, with sending. Okay, the first problem I had with sending oral cues is that, of course, the performer needs to hear themselves. This is always a problem when people have click tracks and so on. Maybe it's in one ear, and that can. I mean, you deal with it if you have to, but especially for the flute, I find that one's constantly listening to oneself. And maybe also the way that the instrument is oriented, you know, maybe...
Well, from my perspective, I do want to hear the maquette, but I also want to perceive myself in the room.
Yeah.
So if I'm completely blocked off, then it doesn't make any sense to me.
We were talking also when you're practicing with piccolo, and you have to use earphones, and it's very earplugs. It's very
on one side. Yeah. So your hearing is lopsided.
Yeah, and it's the sense of hearing the room. That's true. If you have both ears open, that's really when you're hearing the space. So what I'm using is bone conduction headphones, which leave the ears clear. So shall we try? So what I'm going to do is well, let's just do it. Okay. Do you want to be closer to the microphone? Maybe you could be. Yeah.
Sorry.
Oh, sorry. we were kind of deciding whether you should hear the maquette afterwards or not. I don't know if you're maybe curious, maybe should we listen to the maquette a little bit? So that would have been, I should say, that would have been actually one instrumental part in several parts making up the maquette, but that was not the solo part. So maybe I'll just play a little bit what the actual maquette would sound like there. This is the rock sound. This is this is the actual. I'll just play a little bit of it. So that sounds really quite distant, doesn't it? Oh, pardon. That's because I played the whole part. So this... See, to me, I can hear this exactly. So what it has is it has these areas, harmonic areas, that are changing over time. So maybe you hear that there's a more time stretch version that we were doing. You hear a harmonic area and then a little bit of a shifting, and then a harmonic area and then a little bit of a shifting. So the idea would be to, since I'm doing this kind of structural analysis, to have one sort of band which is dedicated to one instrument and then another band which is dedicated to another. Each is listening to their part this way. It has specific techniques that they're doing related to that part, and then and then the combined whole should make this, actually something new, which is what I'm talking about here. The simultaneity of all these repetitions, with the differences in kind and rhythm, their respective displacements and disguises, and this could also be all of the different things of the tension of the, as I say, the different tunings of the different performances, the rhythmic differences in them, which I'm smoothing out in some ways, their divergences or the decenterings, to embed them in one another and envelop one another in illusions, the effect of which varies in each case. And if you know in Différence et Répétition, what he goes on to say is that this relates to actually everyday life and our experience of difference in everyday life and our way of perceiving the world. Thank you.
Thank you. Generation of surplus constantly, in a way.
The generation of
surplus, if you like, of something in excess.
So
could you kind of take your, for instance, your version of Fleckenland, I'm not going to say the Danish, and remove from it all of the spectral components which are actually in the maquette from your performance of your version of Fleckenland and see what's left? Because there must be all sorts of stuff introduced in resultant tones and additional noise and things like that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, of course, what I didn't talk about too much is that I just mentioned in passing this idea of filtering. So, for instance, what Richard was listening to was a very, very filtered version, and you could hear from what he was doing that it was a very limited band of material. Yes, but of course, what they're always, just as you say, there's always the addition of the spectrum. Although I do two ways of doing this. I do have one way of orchestrating from the maquette, which actually takes into account the timbre of each instrument. So there is a way of doing that predictively. If you see, maybe you've seen this, the software from IRCAM, Orchide, and something else called Orchid, which does this kind of process. Sometimes I do these concatenative processes, which are these combinations. So in that case, that's actually taken into account.
Right.
But of course, there's the noise of the instruments, there's always timbral differences, right, which come in. And actually, I think that's a fascinating idea. There would probably, what I would imagine is it would be this extremely noisy kind, you know, because it's the harmonic material which are matching so carefully. So if you took out that harmonic material, you would probably have this very noisy, and it would be more about the instruments in a way, wouldn't it?
So you'd have the trace of the trace of several skeletons.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Just struck me today, listening to Richie interpreting that filter spectrum. Have you considered having him do multiple takes of the same passage, and then using that to create a maquette, and then make that the basic material from which you make the score?
No, I haven't, but I think I will.
Because that way you've got a different kind of, you're introducing new agency, different kinds of variations.
Yes. Well, I'm glad in any case that you say the word agency, because that's really key. Because the idea is that I know that when I listen to these compositions now, I gave you, you know, when I played the Folklarknall, I gave you a sample of listening to the maquette and then listening to the piece, but most people don't have that opportunity. And again, it's not about that. However, I know that I listened to the result differently because of that, so I wanted to bring the performer into that process. And that's in a sense, I mean, in a way we're swapping roles, because I'm thinking of myself as an interpreter of his past, and I would like the performer to maybe have this role as the creative part. So that's actually two very interesting compositions.